Dinner with his friends, his foot washing, to the crucifixion on Good Friday and the resurrection on Easter Sunday. And so as we can this week, we will be with one another electronically. You will be receiving a resource via email shortly this week. Those of you who are on the parish list and any others who want it, just let us know from our bishop to help you celebrate at home these occasions. And next Easter Sunday, we'll be back here with a wonderful celebration for you as well. And so while we would normally be gathered outside right now, blessing palms and praying again, we are in here. And we are adorned with beautiful new hangings and this beautiful old hanging from Hosanna's. We now take time to hear the story of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. Emailed to you was a order of service, or you can find it online by going to St. Aidan's Facebook page. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Hosanna in the highest.
Dear friends in Christ, during Lent we have been preparing for the celebration of the Lord's Paschal Mystery. On this day our Lord Jesus Christ entered the holy city of Jerusalem in triumph. The people welcomed him with palms and shouts of praise, but the path before him led to self-giving, suffering, and death. Today we greet him as our King, although we know his crown is thorns and his throne a cross. We follow him this week, from the glory of the palms to the glory of the resurrection, by way of the dark road of suffering and death. United with him in his suffering on the cross, may we share his resurrection and new life. Let us pray. Assist us mercifully with your help, Lord God of our salvation, that we may enter with joy into the celebration of those mighty acts whereby you give us life and immortality, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
When they had come near Jerusalem and had reached Bethphage at the Mount of Olives, Jesus said to two disciples, saying to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, just say this, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them immediately." This took place to fulfill what had been spoken through the prophet, saying, "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did as Jesus had directed them. They brought the donkey and the colt and put their cloaks on them, and he sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of him and that followed were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven." When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was in turmoil, asking, "Who is this?" The crowds were saying, "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It is right to praise you, Almighty God, for the acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Hebrews acclaim Jesus as Messiah and King, and with palm branches in their hands, crying, Hosanna in the highest. May we also, carrying these emblems, go forth to meet Christ and to follow him on the way that leads to eternal life, who lives and reigns with you in glory, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Let us go forth in peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Before the evil.
Thank you.
A reading from Paul's letter to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that it was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Second reading this morning is the reading of our Lord's Passion. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. Now at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. And at that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you? Jesus Barabbas, or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they had handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with this innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowds to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to him, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." Then he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather a riot was beginning, he took some water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." Then the people as a whole answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." So he released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him, and they took the reed and they struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and they put his own clothes on him. And then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. And they compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to the place that is called Golgotha, which means place of the skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and they kept watch over him. Over his head they put a charge against him which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself if you are the Son of God. Come down from that cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and the elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He can't save himself. He is the King of Israel. Let him come down from this cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he wants to. For he said, 'I am God's son.'" The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "This man is calling for Elijah." At once, one of them ran and got a sponge and filled it with sour wine and put it on a stick and gave it to him to drink. But others said, "Wait, wait, let's see if Elijah will come and save him." Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice, and he breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs were also opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified. And they said, "Truly, this man was God's son." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
I speak to you in the name of God, who is our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, as we enter into this Holy Week, we hear the words of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hail to this beautiful one." As we make our journey this week, we know that those cries of Hosanna will soon turn to the words, "Crucify him." And we're reminded of those words in the Gospel today. I want us to be reminded today that Jesus made his entry into Jerusalem as an act of great faith and really of defiance. While the parade was on of all the military might coming into the city, Jesus makes his way in quietly and humbly, standing against empire, standing against kingdom building, standing against extortion and the abuse of power. Jesus comes humbly, meekly, not on horse and chariot, but on a donkey. And he comes with a witness of his ministry, which had said that life of kingdom building was about building a new kingdom, where love, justice, and peace prevail, where those who are last are first, where the hungry are fed, where the captives are set free, where there is no more need for prisoner, where lion and lamb lie together. Today we can hear echoing in our ears the words of Jesus
when he entered the temple and picked up the scroll of Isaiah, and said with great faith that now the appointed time has come to bring liberty to the captives, the healing of the sick, and the feeding of all who need feeding. Indeed, when social evil had become the status quo, this is the time that Jesus speaks. I can't help but think, as we find ourselves now, I guess a month into this time of isolation, that we too are having our priorities reordered. That at this time we're being reminded that indeed there are those among us who have not been valued. That the powers and principalities of this world have took advantage of too many, too long, and too often. That we have taken for granted those who do work for us that make us have lives that flourish. I can't help but think that in my own heart, my priorities have been realigned. And perhaps that's true for you too. Perhaps we see our doctors and our nurses, our city municipal workers in a different light. Perhaps if you, like me, have found your way into a grocery store or a market or even a Tim Hortons and had someone who needs to wear protective gear to serve us, to make sure we have some of the necessities of life, and God help us, even beyond that, right now we still have to have our Tim Hortons coffee. Many of these are young people. The one young person who told me, I told her family, who told me that she decided she wanted to continue to work in the grocery store because she's a team player. Not afraid, but worried. On this Palm Sunday, as we enter into Holy Week, I wonder if perhaps the social evils that have become status quo around us might be something that, as we sing our hosannas, we may speak to the need to reorder who we are. That the time is coming, and I'm sure is not too far off, when we will get back to some sense of normalcy. And when we do, will we remember the social evils of the time before we entered into this? I think of a very apt example, and that was really around the status quo of the American South in the time of segregation. People were separate but equal, they said. No need to dramatize the racist underbelly of what that is. That's just the way it was. Yesterday was the anniversary of the death of Martin Luther King, who on Palm Sunday preached a powerful sermon in 1957, reminding us that we will indeed follow in the footsteps of Jesus, even if it means pain and suffering. So, any sort of a movement that moved towards liberty, life, civil liberty for all, certainly caught the attention of any and many whites who were complacent, if not racist. And in the early 60s, after a series of failures in gaining the attention of the media, the movement set its sights on Birmingham, Alabama. Numerous attempts at mobilizing blacks to march had largely failed, as most were justifiably fearful of being fired by their white employers. The breakthrough came on Palm Sunday, April 7, 1963. On that day, a march was planned in a black neighborhood for 2 p.m. They had 22 demonstrators show up. They were committed to march, a comparatively large number compared to most marches, because, as I said, most were understandably afraid of being fired or worse. But organizing what it is, being what it is, they weren't ready to march at 2 o'clock. In fact, they weren't ready to march until 4 p.m. But by this time, most blacks were home from work, and knowing of the planned march, about 1,000 or so lined the 3-block route to watch as spectators. And of course, the next day, the paper got it wrong. They reported that more than 1,000 demonstrators marched. As one leader in the movement said, they can only see through white eyes. They can't distinguish between Negro demonstrators and Negro spectators. All they see is Negroes. This reporting elicited a response from Police Commissioner Bill Connor, and with later marches, the media saw, reported, and photographed the violent face of segregation. And that was the beginning of change. The eventual success of the civil rights movement may blind us to its origins, because it may seem to us that we remember events like Selma and other large moments, but it was this simple march of 22 people on a Palm Sunday that changed the course of the civil rights movement. In its beginnings, it was a small seed, small but courageous, a determined action, an action that found its strength in weakness. Perhaps an expression, as they say in Philippians, the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. So, as we say, blessed are those who come in the name of the Lord, maybe we may be so bold as to proclaim all who, before belief, before they even know what faith is, those in their actions who come before the name of the Lord. Jesus and his band of followers were small. They did a simple thing. They walked into the midst of the image of empire with a simple act. And here we are talking about it yet today. Those folks on Palm Sunday on April 7, 1963, planned a simple act, a small group of ordinary people. And that seed of faith changed the course of history forever. In this moment of challenge, this moment of isolation, we may find ourselves despairing. But let us look to this as an opportunity for us to be the church that we've always been called to be, to lift up those laid low, to break the chains of oppression, to take this time when we see the seeds of what might be. How heartened I am to see our Bishop Todd Townsend on social media reminding people that all that we see now, all the major governments of the world have found billions and billions of dollars. This is the time to talk about a guaranteed basic income. This is the time to talk about those who struggle with homelessness. We've housed 50 in London alone this week in motels. When we need to do it, we can do it. Let us find the simple acts during this Holy Week, during this Lent, and as we journey towards this time of incredible triumph in the Easter moment, be a people who display what it looks like to interrupt the evil social status quo. I pray this week, my friends, that you would know the presence of God in the Holy Spirit. Perhaps you've been able to hear it on this video, but the geese are on the roof. The geese are a reminder to us, and as the Celts tell us, of the Holy Spirit. And so as we journey today, we journey knowing that we do not walk alone. May God give us all that we need on this journey. In Jesus' name.
Oh,
standing as you are able, let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. As we enter this holy week together, let us pray for the church, those in need, and all of God's creation. The response to each prayer is, "Your mercy is great." Let us pray for the church throughout the world, that our sisters and brothers in every land be renewed in the mystery of Christ's death and resurrection. In our own church, we pray for Todd, our bishop, Anne, our metropolitan, Linda, our primate, Mark, our national indigenous archbishop, Martinez, the bishop of Amazonia, our sister diocese. And we pray for faith leaders of all religions as they seek to find a way to be present to their people in whatever way. And we pray, especially this Holy Week, that congregations all over will find new ways to journey with Jesus through that final week of his earthly life to the glorious resurrection on Easter Sunday. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Let us pray for the fragile gift of creation, that our world's many scars and sufferings find healing in God's mercy. We do give thanks for all the signs of spring that surround us, that there is new life springing up all around. Hear us, O God,
for your mercy is great.
Let us pray for the nations of the world, especially where betrayal and injustice reign. God's children perish by the sword of violence. We do pray that a good result coming out of all this will be that injustice will be addressed, that we will find ways to meet the needs of all people, that no one need be homeless, nobody need suffer poverty or violence. Hear us, O God,
for your mercy is great.
Let us pray for those in need, for those who are grieved or distressed, lonely or despairing, ill or in pain. We pray for all those who are suffering from the virus, those who are taking care of them, those who are worrying about loved ones, those who are grieving the loss of loved ones through any kind of illness, who are not able to say their goodbyes to them in the normal way. For all those who are alone in hospital right now with nobody to visit them, we give thanks for all those who have to go out into the world while the rest of us stay in our homes as much as possible. They go out to help us to be able to carry on with our lives. All the health workers, but also all those who work in the grocery stores or any other essential services that help our lives to carry on. Hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
We pray for all those who were preparing for baptism and confirmation. Pray, Lord, that you will be with them, and when we are able to celebrate in the future, there will be even more rejoicing. Hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
Let us give thanks for the saints whose faithful witness, even unto death, has given to us the gift of the gospel. We do pray for all those who have died during this time from any cause, who have had to die alone. We pray, Lord, that they knew your presence with them. Hear us, O God.
For your mercy is great.
Into your hands, O God of love, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. This is a prayer on the way to Jerusalem. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts. O living God, age after age, the children of dust make their way to holy places to seek you. Yet you are closer than hands or feet. In temples and in churches, people make sacrifices and offerings. But what you seek is the love and well-being of your children. Your word promises that those whose hands are clean and those whose hearts are pure can climb the heavenly hill. But who are we to do that? On our journey through life, our hearts and our hands have become stained and dirtied. If we have stretched out our hands in greed or lust or love of money, Lord, cleanse us by your mercy. If our hearts have been sullied by pride or resentment, Lord, cleanse us by your mercy. If we have turned aside from our pilgrimage to follow the world's ways or to seek false gods or spirits other than your Holy Spirit, Lord, cleanse us by your mercy. Lord, you forgive the sins of all who turn to you in sincerity. You cleanse the penitent heart from all uncleanliness. Lord, set our course according to your word, so that we may take up afresh the challenge of the journey to the holy city. Give us new strength to follow you on your way, so that even we may ascend the hill of the Lord and stand in the holy place. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. This is a collect for our healthcare workers. Almighty God, your Son, Jesus Christ, traveled extensively, doing good and healing many forms of sickness and disease among the people. We ask that you would continue his gracious work among us. Cheer, heal, and sanctify the sick. Grant to the doctors, surgeons, and nurses wisdom and skill, sympathy and patience, and send down your blessing upon all who work to prevent suffering and those who carry out your works of love. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
And this is our collect for today. Almighty and ever-living God, in tender love for all our human race, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to take our flesh and suffer death upon a cruel cross. May we follow the example of his great humility and share in the glory of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Gathering our prayers and praises into one, let us pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face to shine on us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and grant us peace. Amen.
Thank you, Anne. I just wanted to express our gratitude today for this team of folks who are here to make this possible for you, for Iain, who is bringing you a high-definition video here that will be on YouTube a little later this afternoon. Thank you, Catherinanne, for your beautiful singing and for bringing us our Facebook Live. To you, Anne, for being our officiant today, and of course to David for his gift of music ministry. And I hope for all of you out there, because I want to say thank you to all of you, I hope that for you it is in some way a break from this isolation, that somehow or another it brings us together. So this week, on Tuesday and Thursday mornings, there will be a Zoom morning prayer, which I can send you the invitation for if you let me know. A Wednesday morning prayer at 10 o'clock, and a Wednesday evening Vespers at 6:56. So if you let us know, we'll make sure you're on to that. We'll try and get word out where possible. Each day I'm on at 3:27 with a word of assurance, which we're glad to see you're watching. And please share with your friends and family. And remember, most importantly, to continue to wash your hands and do so properly. Make sure you get all the parts, you know, singing and thumbs and palms and all that. And stay at home. Just stay at home. Whatever else you do, unless you really need to get out for a grocery shop or something like that, please let us do what we can to listen to and heed the words of our health officials to flatten the curve, or as Dr. Tam has been saying, plank the curve, although I've never been good at planking, but we're working on that. Please keep all that in mind to do what you can to help. These next couple of weeks are critical. And most of all, continue your prayers for all who are working to help us get through this. For Dr. Chris Mackey and all the people here at Middlesex London Health Unit, as well as people at health units across the country, and certainly for all those on the front line. We offer our incredible gratitude from our farmers to our truckers, to the store clerks and the people stocking the shelves, to all those restaurants, those independent businesses that are trying to remain open, doing takeout, showing your support. And also to certainly all who are in our hospitals, our doctors, nurses, our administrators, and PSWs in our nursing homes. You're incredible people, and you're doing yeoman's work. And to those of you who are right now, I want to say a word, suffering because you've got loved ones in the hospital. And I know here in our own parish, there are a few of you. You are in our prayers, as are your loved ones. And as we all know people now with COVID-19, we also know people who are in the hospital for things unrelated to that, who are very lonely. And so keep those folks in your prayers and reach out to your friends who have someone in the hospital so that they can know your love and presence as well. So I'm going to invite us to sing together Ride On in Majesty. And then who knows how David will have us ride on after we sing. He's always got some special trick in his bag for his postlude. But thank you all for spending time with us on Facebook Live today. If you've got the order of service at home, make these words ring out in your kitchen or your living room or your study, wherever you are. Sing with us, Ride On in Majesty.
This is the old rugged cross.